Hold on. And we've got a second intro from Lewis this week. Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to Resonance Arcade. We just did do some broadcasting, if anybody was watching, but there was no sound whatsoever. If you just want me, I'm just going to quickly explain what I already explained. We're winging it this week, and that's why I didn't do all my normal checks and make sure everything was right. I just thought, oh, bugger it, we'll go live. But everything broke. So thank you to Wutt, Potato Power, and my wife for letting us know that they couldn't hear me.
I don't think we should thank Potato, to be honest. I think he kept it quite cryptic, whereas your Door of Justice...
Yes.
There you know.
So thank you to my wife, my lovely, lovely wife, for letting us know via the medium of telepathic doors. Yes. So this week we're winging it. We're just talking about games that we've played. We were just briefly talking about Diablo 3, so we might as well just get straight back into that. I was just saying that I found the single player game way too easy.
Incredibly, even to the point where I just stop playing it because it's just not interesting walking around being able to kill everything with one hit.
I'm kind of at that point with it because the single player was a little bit I was quite enjoying the story and I like the look of the game and the feel of it, but the single-minded mechanic is what I think gets me annoyed. I think about games, it's like I keep talking about things like, you know, playing Killing Floor constantly. I know you guys enjoy it sometimes, but it's the same thing over and over and over, and that I found that the same, just loot, fight, loot, nothing else to it really.
I think it was a challenge with that game. I think we tried to challenge ourselves, but I think
you're talking about Diablo or Killing
no,
Floor?
No, talk about Killing Floor.
I was still talking about Diablo. I just mentioned that as an example.
I was wondering where the loot came from, so I don't remember getting loot in Killing Floor.
No, I meant the loot in general, and yeah. that's basically what you play the game for, to get better loot. There's not really much else in that game to me. I mean, the story's interesting, but surely you can only play it through it once.
Yeah. And it's not as if there's like a different mechanic introduced when you get a boss or any of that. It's just a case of the same thing. You run over, kick away, press whatever action you've got assigned to your four keys, and just wait for it. But you came round and saw my character load, didn't you?
It was ridiculous. You were regenerating health faster than any boss could take it off you.
What's the point in continuing to play? Because there's no challenge. So as Chris said, all you're doing is looking for better loot.
The thing is, Steve, you have a history of any game that's an RPG-style game where you've got leveling or you've got the ability to upgrade your character. You tend to always find a build which just breaks the game. Like, I remember your Oblivion and Morrowind and Skyrim characters just being ridiculous.
Well, so are mine. If you play any of my Skyrim characters, I'm insanely powerful in them. But I still enjoy playing those games because there's a lot more to them.
Tanks shouldn't be that powerful. Tanks should be able to absorb damage, but not...
Well, that's
you shouldn't have an easy time.
That's actually what I meant. I didn't mean I'm particularly dealing loads of damage. I just meant it.
You are having an easy time about it, though.
In Morrowind, I got the point where I could kill anything with one hit quite quickly. Oblivion, it took a little bit longer. Skyrim was really quick for me to get that point again.
Mm. Yeah.
One-hit kills. And I could change the way I play and not go for a tank and try to play stealthily, but I enjoy playing as a tank.
Yeah, we talked about that, because it's unfair that you should have to change your chosen class because that class is unbalanced. It's the same way I play stealth, and when I played stealth in Oblivion... The stealth in Oblivion wasn't worked out that well, and it turned out it made it really hard.
I played stealth in all those games mainly, and I really enjoyed it and didn't find any problems.
I enjoyed it, but it wasn't easy.
I mean,
certainly wasn't easy. In Skyrim, if you play a stealth character, then the dragons are not susceptible to stealth.
I got to disagree. I think the stealth was dead easy in those games because once you get to a certain point, it's almost you can walk in front of people while you're in stealth mode and they don't see you. But in Morrowind, I found it extremely difficult. Like, there's a shop in Balmoral. And it was the first shop with all the armor in it. And I remember trying to go in there and steal everything, but the guards just kept twatting me because I was dead weak at the time. And I found that really, really difficult because, I don't know, the leveling was different.
Maybe it's all about the approach, because the first thing that I normally do in any RPG game is you need to build your strength up. Regardless of anything else, strength is the first priority.
Only on your class builds, though. If you played Diablo 3 as a witch doctor, your main attribute is... what is it? Intelligence, yeah. Yeah, strength doesn't come into it, and if you build strength up, it's pointless.
But on kind of like an open slate game, like at the Elder Scrolls, where your actions define what you're doing, it's strength first, but then you can branch off into things like stealth and what have you. And obviously you have to do stealth if you want to, you know, get the top of the Thieves Guild and the Dark Brotherhood and stuff like that. You need to do them stealth things. So you do learn it, but the difference then is you're doing stealth when you've got, like, the power of a charging elephant behind you. Which doesn't really make much difference because you can one-hit kill in stealth on the Elder Scrolls games anyway once you get a high enough level.
But the strength of my character, as in how good he hits, doesn't really come into it unless I'm fighting, like, a boss or out adventuring.
In Elder Scrolls, strength is directly related to the amount of health you've got and the amount of stuff you can carry, isn't it? It's not really about how hard you hit.
But either way, I mean, it doesn't really come into it that much with me. I'm not... when I play those games specifically, I don't really fight. I just stealth everywhere and try and steal things and run away from them. And I don't want to fight any guards because I don't want to ruin towns.
I have a certain brand of stealth, and that's kind of assassination stealth. I like to sneak around and kill people. Or sneak around and disable people somehow.
Yeah, I would never do that. Or disable, yes. As long as I don't kill them, I'm generally like that. I do like to disable people and make it easier for myself. But
In Skyrim especially, the Thieves Guild and certainly the Dark Brotherhood was some of the most rewarding missions for me. I loved the Dark Brotherhood missions in Oblivion as well. There was a mission in Oblivion where you had to sneak into someone's house and loosen a statue on the wall where they slept, and it fell on them. I loved that.
Remember that?
I could play an entire game just all about that. I think that was brilliant.
Well, that's the good thing about the Elder Scrolls games is you can play them any way you want.
Yeah, and they actually got someone in specifically. It was a guy who worked on Theif, I believe. They got him in to do the stealth system for Oblivion and Skyrim. That's why those games took on a proper stealth system with kind of a light gem and things like that, a visibility meter, whatever you want to call it.
Not the new Theif, obviously.
No, God.
No, I think Garrett actually programmed that game himself.
What an awful game. What a disappointment after the trailers, which looked really good.
You know what? What would have made the game more tolerable and actually got me to the point where I wanted to complete it would if they removed all of them bloody horrible transitions between areas. The main thing for me was whenever you opened a window, it was the same animation. You couldn't skip it, and it took 3 or 4 seconds. And it was like, this isn't real. This is removing me from control of the game. This is taking away the my God-given right to run around in this game and do what the hell I want, which is what games are about, you know?
It is, yeah, but a lot of developers, especially AAA developers, think that the game is about being an interactive movie.
Yes.
With less emphasis on every interaction.
Yeah, you're right, but I mean, I've got to disagree there. I've been recently designing something in my game. I've been designing a rooftop like chase scene, and I'm doing it as I go. I haven't actually drawn anything down this time. I'm just seeing how I get with it. Every single time that I put something together, I'm thinking of you, Lou. I'm thinking about how you would approach it, and I'm like, this is right. So how do I think outside the box here? How can I make this a viable game option, but make it feel like it's not viable, you know, make it feel like you're cheating the game or you've done something clever with the mechanics of the game. I actually, yesterday as well, sorry, I'm going off on one. I actually accidentally, did some emergent gameplay in my game. I was running, right? I've built a mechanic where you can wall run. You can kind of like curve over a wall if you hold right, strafe or left strafe against a wall and then jump while you're in parkour mode, and it kind of pushes you over. Now, one thing that I also built is if you run straight into a wall and then you can run up the wall and then flip backwards and jump off. I didn't actually think I did it by accident the other night. If you wall run into a wall, it actually wall runs across the wall, and then when you jump, when you've hit the wall, you jump backwards off the wall. So it's quite a cool little mechanic and trick to do, but it was totally emergent because I didn't
Please keep that in the game. Please keep
that. No, I am. There's no reason for... I was really excited. I think Potato was actually in the channel yesterday. I was doing some streaming, and I did it by accident. I was like, oh, my God. No one responded to me in the chat, but I was like, I've just done this. It's brilliant. It's like, that was really cool that I accidentally put something into a game that actually really works really well.
And now you know how Carmack feels.
No, I don't, because he hates it, doesn't he?
Yeah, he doesn't like it. He feels like everything like that is a... there's a blemish against his record of perfect programming.
Yeah, I could easily program that out, but I don't want to because it is actually a mechanic that I was intending potentially to put in. You know, I was thinking about it, but I never actually tried it. Never once thought, oh, this will work, because I must have rearranged the order of some code because I've got a fairly hefty, bigger than I would normally put in there, but fairly hefty switch statement that basically chooses, and I think I rearranged some of the parkour movements so one takes priority over the other, and that's why it now does it. So I made a mistake, and it's better for it, I think.
Well done.
Yeah.
It's even better for the fact that you recognise that it's not only a mistake, but a mistake that improves the game.
Oh, definitely. It gives you more fidelity and movement and ability to, you know, actually get from one place to another. I like it. And I've actually already started putting things into the game that relate to that mechanic. You can get on, like, these platforms that I've put in, you can get on them via other means, but it's quicker. So I'm thinking of speedrunners as well while I'm doing it. I'm thinking of how this person's going to plan a route using all the mechanics and the physics that I've put into the parkour stuff to actually get from one place to another. And it makes me quite excited thinking about that, even though no one will probably play it, you know, apart from Potato and Myth.
Me? I want to play it.
And you.
I might give it a quick pass.
You two are paying for it.
Yeah, of course.
Because there's only going to be four people buying it. I might as well.
Steel build like a big heavy character. It'd be like super stealth heavy man.
I'll tell you what.
Instead of hacking machines, just punch them.
I'll get it published. I'll get it published and then I'll torrent it.
Steal this software.
Yes, dear EA or Ubisoft or anyone who wants to publish my game. None of the above, by the way. I will torrent the game after you've published it. Sorry. Other games we've been playing.
I'm going to throw a bit of a wild card at you. I've been playing the new SimCity.
Good lad. SimCity back in the day.
The one that was broken for a long time.
Yes. Released in 2013 and got nothing but complaints because no one could connect to a server. Right. They have added an offline mode in it recently, though. It's quite enjoyable.
Is it not annoying that you're kind of limited in the size of your city or something? It doesn't have like regions or something. They're very small.
Yeah, but what you can do is you have a region which has got areas for several cities, and you can apply to be mayor of multiple ones of these, then set up trade routes and exchanges between the cities.
Right.
And then you can have it so that, you know, you have one city which is primarily residential. If everyone to stay, then you have like your main industrial city where people would commute to, and it's got quite a lot of scope. Build individual buildings as well.
Did you not do that in the original SimCity, though? Did you not build areas that were... I did whenever I played it.
City, and you could just expand it on this. Like your city limits are established; you can't go any further beyond them.
Ah, right.
So you get given a size piece of land, and you have to work within that. So it's limiting from that respect. But you don't build houses anymore; you set up residential zones.
That's you've always done that.
No, you used to be able to plonk.
No, out. Even the original SimCity, you set up a residential zone, and it built houses in that zone for you, and they got bigger. It did.
No, it didn't. I remember playing the SimCity where I had to individually place blocks of residential, commercial, or industrial buildings. And that was on the SNES, maybe, even the PC.
You zone them. You put special buildings in there, like police stations and stuff. But you zone residential, industrial, and commercial zones. They grow themselves. That's always been the case in SimCity.
There were still individual areas. Like you put down, this is a residential block, single square block or whatever, that's residential, and it may grow. I can't remember if it grew or not, I'll be honest.
Yeah, that's been that one kid to play the SimCity game. I just kind of thought I fancy playing SimCity.
For me, the joy...
And it was on Origin, the complete pack for £12, I think.
For me, the joy of SimCity has always been just in the build, not in the playing of the game. I've always not really enjoyed the game.
There's a built-in sandbox mode.
Yeah, that's probably what I'd play.
Yeah, but you it's got quite a lot of scope for different transports. You can there's maglev stuff in there and everything as well. As normal kind of trains, buses, monorails, boats.
Does it still have the natural disasters and unnatural disasters you can unleash upon the world?
Godzilla.
You get an alien coming down and smashing it and everything.
Yeah. Specialise in industries or get them all. You know, it's quite good. I'm not bored of it yet, but it won't last forever.
It's strange that our typical thing with games is to wait for a couple of years until they've matured before we play them. We're playing Diablo 3 now, a couple of years after its release, when it's finally kind of working. Because people complained about that a lot when it first came out. SimCity, again, same sort of thing. Thinking back of the games that I played this year, they've primarily been games that were released a couple of years before this year.
Mm.
Like, a big part of the year was spent playing Borderlands 2. And all the DLCs, and we basically hammered the hell out of that. We played it through to overpower level 7 or something, which is one off basically end game.
No, I didn't even know that existed.
Yeah, you and Greg.
Yeah, me and Greg. So we played through normal, then true Vault Hunter mode, then ultimate Vault Hunter mode, and then we went to OP levels 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and there's 8 OP levels.
So you played through the game that many times?
No, you only played through the game fully 3 times for normal, true, and ultimate, and then you play through Digistruct Peak for your OP levels.
All right.
Yeah, we hammered the hell out of it. I put many hours into
Borderlands. It sounds like a big investment in time.
Yeah, I haven't got time to repeat myself in a game like that. Doesn't do much for me these days.
Yeah, Whoopatear Power is saying there that you couldn't play Diablo 3 when it came out. That's the experience I had with it. It was basically really laggy because even single-player games ran on a server. And it was just annoying.
Yeah. I didn't try it. I've only just got it because you guys said you were playing it, and then you didn't, and then you have.
I've been trying to.
Yeah, I'm you've been sending obscure messages to everyone, like, you know. I can't be asked for that. Yeah, well, text me.
Right.
Text me, darling.
Text me sexy.
I will do.
Other games I've been playing, obviously Terraria. For those who don't know what Terraria is, I'm going to explain it now. It is a building game. It's a 2D Minecraft with a lot more in it, essentially. Probably one of the best ones I've tried. I've tried a fair few of them now. But Terraria was just a little bit more, I don't know, interesting. We got to the end game recently. We actually set up a dedicated server, and all three of us were playing. And I've pretty much got all the best weapons, all the best armors, and, you know, killed nearly all the bosses. There's only a couple that we haven't. But it was thoroughly enjoyable while we were playing it.
I really enjoyed it.
I still have a go on it every now and again. I just start a new world.
I like how much there was to do.
Mm, but I don't know if it's that repeatable, you know?
No.
I mean, I am playing it a bit more, but it's only because I'm a bit addicted to it, I think. I can't put it down.
There is a game coming next year. The Kickstarter should be any time now, called Moon Man.
Yeah.
The website is moonman.io. And that is a beautiful looking game. I've been following the progress of that game for years now. And I'm really excited to see what it's going to do. I know it won't have as much to do as Terraria, but it just looks great. It looks fantastic. And that's kind of enough for me to want to buy it or fund it on Kickstarter.
I'll give it a go when it's out. You know, I'm not too keen on pre-releases and that term for games that are out, early access. Why can't I never remember that one? What's wrong with me? What's wrong with my brain? I'm not keen on early access. I actually got an early access game from the Steam sale, which was someone that I was doing the MMO buff show. It's actually his game, Fortress Craft. And I played it a little bit, and I didn't really get too much out of it. I did try and figure a lot of the stuff out, but I don't know, it's just not quite at the stage where I can invest, I want to invest too much time in it, you know?
It broke when I tried to play it.
Yeah?
Speaking about early access, you'd be interested to know, possibly, that Chaos, the game that I'm trying to do a remake of badly, Chaos Reborn, comes out on Steam Early Access on the 9th of December. You can view it on there now. It's looking pretty nice, I must say.
Yeah, I want to give that that I like the idea of the sound of chaos. I've never played it, but I like the sound of the mechanic. And I'd be keen on that, I think.
So I think everyone watching now should give that a look, because if it's anything to go by, this is the guy who made XCOM, the original. It should be quite nice. It looks good. So that's another thing I'm looking forward to.
Cool.
You do realize I'm going to kick your ass out.
Probably. You tend to do that with turn-based games. You are the strategy master.
I just intimidate you.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Fucking hurry up, take a movie, dickhead.
I also got a copy of from one of our chat members. Actually, I got a copy of Star Citizen the other day, which is it's a 2D again builder explorer, procedurally generated.
StarBound, isn't it?
Star Citizen's a 3D one that's cost £1 million.
Yeah.
StarBound. Sure, it said Star Citizen. I knew both the names, but I'm sure I read Star Citizen. Anyway.
There's another one called Starforge as well, so that's even more confusion. But it's StarBound.
I remember seeing this a while back, and I've been wanting to grab it for a while. I nearly grabbed it last week, so I'm quite lucky, I think, that I didn't, because he sent me a gift on Steam, so I've got a copy of it.
And what's your opinion?
I haven't played it yet. But I do really, really want to play it. It's my next, when I get a bit of time, my next one to give a go.
I'm kind of in a bit of a lull at the minute when it comes to games. SimCity's been kind of the only that's breaking quite away from the genres I've been playing a lot of recent. Like I got Diablo, and that just was such a letdown.
Yeah,
it's definitely more enjoyable in co-op.
Yeah, but it's still doing the same thing over and over again that I've kind of already done, and it's not giving me any like new rewards.
Mm.
It's just, oh look, you've got another one of these, and there's another one of them, and you know, I had a full set of legendary everything by the Act 2. So
yeah, I was pretty much there.
More legendary stuff.
I actually started chucking legendary stuff away and replacing it with stuff that's slightly better. Oh God, potato!
Steve, have you heard of this game called Minesweeper?
Does Minesweeper even exist on Windows 8 now?
I don't know. I've never looked in the games folder. Is there a games folder?
No, it's not on there.
Games? What have I got in here? Minesweeper!
You're on Windows 7 though, aren't you, Lou?
Yeah, I've got Minesweeper. Yeah.
There's no...
Chris said Windows
8. I'm going to go on Advanced 99 Mines, 16x30 Telegram. Oh, it made a noise.
I don't have Minesweeper. On Windows 8, they've removed it.
Does not have Minesweeper?
Maybe you can install it though separately. There might be a games...
If it comes as like DLC.
How
do
you play this?
From the App Store, won't it?
I just clicked it and died straight away.
It is actually on the App Store.
You clicked it and died.
I clicked a mine. Obviously. Yeah,
it's interesting you said
it's
died.
It's Minesweeper, not mine clicker.
Yeah, I died. My brain flew out and caught fire.
Well, Mythalos just said StarBound is very well made. Basically, Terraria with much more world depth. That's interesting.
Well,
because
based in space.
I think it's all over the place. There's loads of different biomes.
Ooh, I just remembered something, actually. I started playing Space Engineers again.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Okay. I want to get that now, you know.
In survival mode. So starting off, because when it first came out on Alpha, Early Access, you could only really... The survival mode didn't really work very well, so you could only really play the exploration mode, which started you off with everything. So you'd go there and you'd like build a massive ship and then fly off and then get bored really quickly because you're not building up to it.
Right.
So I've started off in survival mode and I died. I started off with a basic kind of space station platform. I think it's attached to an asteroid. And I needed to get some uranium, but there was no uranium on this asteroid and I didn't have a ship. So I just basically waited there and all the power ran out. Died.
That's a grim sort of way that you would really die in space.
Yeah.
That's
slow and boring.
So, yeah. Oh,
we watched Gravity the other day. I haven't seen it till now.
Wish I'd been to see that at the cinema.
It was cool. I actually thought for some reason I had it in my head that it was funded by it was like a celebrity funded one. And I had assumed that, like, Sandra Bullock and what's his face,
George Clooney,
yeah. I assumed that they'd funded it and directed it and got everybody on a profit share. Maybe there was something else around that time that was like that.
Just ring a bell.
The funny thing about Gravity is it actually cost less for the Indians to send an actual probe to Mars than it did to make that film.
100 million it cost to make, and they made 760 odd, I think.
It cost the Indian government, I think it was 70 million equivalent, to design it, to build it, to launch it, and to get it to Mars.
Speaking of Gravity and space exploration, did anyone play Kerbal Space Program?
No, but that's one I want to go of as well.
Yes, I have played that to death.
Yeah, one of my mates, Greg, has played it. He's put hours and hours and hours into it, and he's
I haven't played it as much.
But it's a hard game, apparently.
It's right up your street, though, isn't it, Steve? I bet.
Oh, yeah.
I kind of like these new building games that are coming out and exploring games. You know, things that are a bit more, I don't know, a bit more detailed, but with one specific purpose, you know?
Yeah, like not massive detail everywhere, but kind of focused and down one avenue.
I mean, I haven't played it, but I've seen a few people play it, and I quite like the look of it, quite like the idea.
It's definitely a time eater. It's not something you can shot on for half an hour.
Are either of you interested in the big space games that come in, Star Citizen and Elite Dangerous and stuff like that?
I'm not really that keen on the whole massively multiplayer element of them.
That is my response too. I'm cured of anything that requires me to be online, contact other people and kind of go on repetitive quests over and over and over just to level up. Not interested.
I'm interested in the engine and the mechanics behind it, but actually playing it.
Did you give it a crack at the LAN? You did, didn't you?
Yeah. If there was no one else on the server, then I'd probably enjoy it.
Yeah.
I don't mind that. I think that kind of adds to the... I wouldn't want to be in an entire galaxy that was just me and some AI aliens or whatever.
How do you know you're not?
Well, exactly. But I am going to get... I'm buying a decent joystick for that, a HOTAS, and I'm buying rudder pedals as well. I'm probably a track IR. So I'm spending quite a bit of money on that, but I'm also...
You won't have enough time for all that, Lou, with your
upcoming missions. But I'm also quite interested in playing DCS as well, which is a really nice combat flight simulator.
You're such a Greg sycophant, you are.
Yeah, well, you just dress up as Greg and rub yourself in Greg.
It's not
Greg,
so much that Greg, I want to play it because
Greg plays. By the way, everybody,
yeah,
before
it's
we...
Not, yeah. It's not so much that I want to play it because Greg's playing it. I want to play it because he seems to have found a niche of games which have a lot to offer. Like, DCS is a game that you have to put a lot of time in, and it's rewarding from putting that time in. And I'm kind of feeling like, I know, I think you two are the same.
So, can you explain what these games are to people?
So, Elite Dangerous is a first-person space trading and basically a space simulator. It's got the entire galaxy. It's procedurally generated, but it's the same for everyone. And you basically fly spaceships around and trade and kill people and commit acts of piracy and whatever, but it's a free form kind of almost sandbox space game,
like most of the Elites in the past have been.
Well, like Elite originally was, yeah. Star Citizen is trying to be the same sort of thing, but it doesn't look like it's going to be that way because it's based on the CryEngine, right. And so one of the limitations of the CryEngine is that everything has to be an instance, everything has to be a map. So you basically, you travel around in space, which is empty, and when you get to a location, it loads a map for that location. If you land on a planet, you basically fly into a map of the planet, which is a small section of the planet, that it auto-flies you through, and you land, and then you walk around in a first-person view on the surface, which might be, like, you know, a couple of shops or something. So it's kind of, it has grand delusions of, like, giant universe, but in fact... it's kind of small sections of universe, and I'm not keen on that. I want a space game where I can fly anywhere. I mean, I played EVE Online many years ago when that came out and quickly realized that you don't actually control your ship.
Right.
So you don't fly around in space. You select where you want to go and the ship flies you there. If you want to mine an asteroid, you click on the asteroid and pick mine. So it's basically a browser game.
There's a little bit more to it than that, I think.
there's loads to it, but there's no manual control, which is what you really want. You want to fly around in space.
It's a management game, though, isn't it? It's a space management game, essentially.
Yeah, basically Excel with a pretty front end.
So yeah, yeah.
One thing that strikes me straight away is that flying around in space isn't fun.
No, and because it doesn't require
it's just
much effort.
That it's a lot of space.
Yeah, but that's
so
why
after you get over the kind of, ooh, that sun looks nice, that Asha looks nice, you're thinking, yeah, I'm just going in the same direction constantly without the background really changing that much because it's obviously of that larger scale.
Ah, yes, Mythalos has mentioned No Man's Sky, which is a very interesting one.
It's but getting more interesting the more releasing as well, the more press they're doing.
I have bigger reservations over that, though. I feel like that game will run out of tricks very quickly.
Well, that's what I'm worried about, but I'm still going to get it unless it's really highly priced, which I have a feeling it might be by now.
PS4 exclusive, I think.
Yeah, I've got a PS4, so it'll be about £50, won't it?
I don't know. I just feel like it's done what it's done so far so well that it kind of can't have many tricks left up its sleeve. So once you've seen one pretty planet, you're going to see lots of the same pretty planet with different colours and different flora and fauna.
Well, we were talking about procedurally generated stuff a while back, and we were talking specifically about Terraria being quite good at it. It's quite interesting the way that it forms a world. It doesn't really feel like the same world or the same bits that you go into, but it's quite simple with it being 2D. But with it being 3D, I mean, when I went into Fortresscraft the other day, for example, that's procedurally generated, and it was just a mass of green and trees. That was it. You know, it didn't seem... And then when you went underground, there was nothing there, but it is in pre-release, so in that word again.
Early access,
so I can't really blame it, you know. But I want something interesting. I want a world to explore. I want a Skyrim procedurally generated type thing, you know. I want that level of detail in my procedural generation.
Yeah. Thing is, Skyrim wasn't procedurally generated, was
it? No,
it
wasn't.
It was handcrafted.
It was handcrafted with kits.
Many years.
Yeah. But, you know, I'm saying that's the kind of stuff that I want in order for procedural generation to be really appealing to me, specifically.
I'm not sold by the
whole idea of massive scale space exploration, because there's nothing in space.
That's why it's called space.
Exactly. So unless they're going to allow you to do things like be able to plot your course around stars and slingshot yourself so you can increase your velocity, unless there's something useful happening in the mechanics, it's pointless. You may as well just point and click and go to that location.
Well, that's what you kind of do, but you basically have your gameplay within those locations, and I it's kind of hypocritical to have a go at Star Citizen, which is basically instances, and then talk about Elite Dangerous like it's not doing the same thing when it is. But Elite Dangerous also has a lot of it's got a lot of things on its list of things to do, like being able to land on completely procedural planets and stuff. Be able to do EVA, so get out of your ship and fix your ship from the outside in a spacesuit. So there's lots of stuff coming for that game which look like it's going to be really good. The problem is it might take so long for them things to be implemented that people lose interest before them.
Yeah, that's the problem that a lot of games, and especially indie developers, have in general.
Artemis has been mentioned in...
I've heard the name, but I don't know what that is, I'm afraid.
I'm just trying to find, because there's lots of things called Artemis. Can you give us a link? Mythalo or Potato
Spaceship
Power?
Spaceship Bridge Simulator.
Oh.
A Spaceship Bridge Simulator? What, as in the bridge? Ah, you mean the flight bridge, right? Sorry, yeah. I thought you meant like a bridge in a space.
This is a bit like that mobile game called where you've all got controls of the ship and it's just random controls and you've got to shout like, you know, super thrusters to 15% and stuff like that before your ship crashes.
Super thrusters.
Yeah, it's like it comes up with ridiculous names. You've got to shout them out and tell your mates to increase them or decrease them or turn them on or turn them off.
It sounds like a multiplayer version of FTL.
It's a party game, so you basically all sit around with your own version of the app. The app connects to all the other people in the room,
right.
And then you're all basically flying a ship into a star, or flying it away from a star, but you're getting dragged into it, and you've got to shout out things to each other. You all act as members of the crew, and you've all got control of certain parts of the ship.
That sounds horrible.
Yeah,
it looks really fun. It looks really fun.
It looks like
it'll
be
it.
a gimmick as opposed to kind of like something you would actually think, oh yes, I can't get home so I can start shouting out, you know, turn the dampening fields on, the inertial dampeners are too high. Oh.
It's called Space Team, a cooperative party game.
Have you played FTL, Steve?
Faster Than Light? Yeah. No, I've seen it.
I think it'd be up right up your street, because it is, it's kind of like a strategy management game. It's really difficult, but it's really fun and addictive.
A version of it on Android. I'm not opposed to trying it.
Yeah, it's. I mean, I haven't got a copy I can give you, unfortunately, but it's. I think it's brilliant. You can have a go at my, on mine after if we do a LAN party again soon.
Yeah. Space Engineers.
Yeah, I'm going to get that, actually.
I think you should get it as well. Then we can build massive ships and crash.
Can we...
So I think that's the only thing you can do in the game. Sorry?
Is it multiplayer?
Oh, yeah, yeah. We can see, I can set up a dedicated server.
Right, interesting.
It's just a case of... you decide what you want to start off with, whether it's like a basic ship, then you got to go around and... Well, it's like Terraria and Minecraft, you got to mine things in order to build better things.
Right, I didn't think it was that in-depth, actually.
Mm. You can get like a mining attachment for the front of your ship, and just for the sake of it, I mined all the way through an asteroid and came out the other side.
It made it into a donut void.
No, it was just like a tiny little hole. The asteroid was quite big.
A very generous donut void.
Steve's got a new toy as well this week.
Yes, yes, I have.
Go on, tell us about it.
I'm not actually allowed to play with it yet, apparently. But that's the control.
No, not your penis.
Got grubby finger marks on it already.
I know, I'm going to have to wipe it.
That's very shiny. That would annoy me.
That's
everything
like
would annoy you.
Massive size of gamepad.
I intend to annoy you. Obviously succeeds. So, Steve's got a Wii. And,
Wii U.
Wii U. Much to Lou's disapproval.
Yeah. Lou hates everything.
I've not heard that much about the Wii U, and I kind of figured it was a flop.
No, it's selling massive numbers.
Is it selling
probably, as with every other Nintendo console, sold more than PS4 and Xbox together?
Is it because it was released at a weird time, not around Christmas? Is that why?
No, the thing is, Nintendo don't boast about the sales. They never have done.
No,
I know, but I just I heard a lot about the DS. I heard a lot about the Wii, but the Wii U kind of came out and everyone took the piss out of the name for a start. No pun intended.
Everyone took the piss out of the name for the Wii.
Yeah, they did, but the Wii U was just really silly. But I just never heard anything more from it. Then it was, I just figured that it just died a death. Like I couldn't imagine Nintendo product ever dying a death. But it just, I'd never heard anything until basically you mentioned it.
I think it's set to be the number one selling console this Christmas.
How much is it?
It varies, but you can get a basic pack for about £160, I think.
So it's substantially cheaper than the Xbox One.
Oh yeah, and then you can get the premium pack, which I think is £240.
Speaking about that, did anyone see the PS4 20th year anniversary edition?
Yeah, the PS4 that's basically
designed like a PS1. Yeah, that was pretty cool. Did you see that, Chris?
Sorry, what?
So today is the 20th anniversary of the original PlayStation, and they released the PS4 special edition, which was in the same colours, a kind of off-white grey colour of the original.
I heard about that. Yeah, someone pointed it out to me the other day. That's pretty cool. I'm just looking at the sales figures for Wii U versus PS4, and I have a feeling Wii U might actually be underperforming for as far as Nintendo goes, because they always beat every time they beat sales.
Yeah,
kick the crap.
You
out
can
of.
Put that down to the price point as well, but I think it is more of a family machine. You know, like parents consider it safe, don't they?
Yeah. Total sales for Nintendo of all time, 676 million. Sony is 442 million. And Microsoft is 113 million.
Yeah, that's all time, though.
All
so
time.
Nintendo...
I'm trying to find the Wii stuff, but yeah, that is all time. Okay, the Wii U has sold 7.29 million. The PlayStation 4 is 13.5, so yeah, it's kicking the crap out of the Wii U. And the Xbox One... 5.1 million, so it's still PS4. Beating the Xbox One. PS4 is... But I got a PS4 this time round as well, because it was a much more appealing console than the others.
Yeah, I found the PS3, it was just wasn't as appealing as the 360, but...
Yeah.
The PS4's got something about it.
I I'm not really loyal to either console. I mean, I was brought up a Nintendo kid, but that was only because that's what I was bought by my parents, you know? Or I bought myself because I was used to buying having Nintendos. But yeah, I went to the Xbox 360. Absolutely loved that console. Still love it now. I still play games on it, as we were playing the other week. And the PS4 just appealed to me much more than the Xbox One, mainly because of all the privacy stuff and all the fact that you needed a Kinect, that you needed this to do it, and that you couldn't download games, or you couldn't you couldn't secondhand games. Yeah. Even though I never ever do that, it still annoyed me that you couldn't.
So it was the bad press that it received that actually made your mind up for you?
That, and the fact that it needs to be online every 24 hours, the fact that it needed... all of these little restrictions that people had picked out and criticised, I just thought, they're not doing the users any favours at all here, you know? I want control over... I'm a power user, if anything. I want more control rather than less control. And if you impose these restrictions on me, it's gonna impede my gaming at some point, probably.
Fair but
the, I mean, the PS3, you know, that you didn't have to be online with it. Your PSN was free. PlayStation Plus, I think, came out at some point, but that's just a subscription service. And then now they're all kind of on a pay scheme, aren't they? I think PlayStation, PS4, actually, in order to play online, you have to pay a subscription fee.
That's awful. Yeah. That is truly awful.
Well, that's what 360 is like as well, though.
So you pay more for the games, and then you've got to pay to play them online.
You pay a lot more
and
for games.
And you wonder why I don't like consoles.
You don't like consoles because you've got spanner hands and you can't use the control pads.
I could if I played them enough, but I don't want to play them because I've got to pay for them.
I like the fact that I can do everything on my PC, but at the same time, I also enjoy the convenience of consoles, you know. I'm really looking forward to a Christmas present I've got coming up, which I told you guys about but I haven't said on the stream. The Last of Us remastered on the PS4. It was on the TV the other day, a couple of days ago, and I turned to the wife and I went, I would really like that game for the PS4. I think I'm going to get it at some point. Knowing Christmas was coming up, and she said, I took the hint. So hopefully that's the right one I'm thinking of. Anyway, that she's got.
Yeah, she might just buy it again for the PS3.
Hey, a couple of years ago, she bought me a game. God bless her. I haven't opened it yet. She got me Little Big Planet 2. And, you know, although I did kind of like the first one a bit, it got boring very quickly. And I didn't even want the second one. But, you know, it's still nice to get a game off the wife. She's not saying I hate you for playing games all the time. It's here you go. Embrace your passion. Validation.
I would really, really, really like to play The Last of Us.
Yeah. I'm really looking forward to it.
But I don't want to buy a console just to play one game.
Well, maybe Ste can lend you his.
I've offered to lend him a PS3.
Yeah, I probably will take you up on that, because I do want to play that game. It's the only game on that machine that I really want to play.
You know what Sam used to do? He used to lend my... Well, when he lived here, he had a PS2 himself and a PS3, but he did occasionally buy Wii and 360 games to play on my stuff. And I don't actually know what happened to him. I think he took them with him when he went, because he had another 360 at someone else's house. But, yeah. Apart from that...
I was going to say, I'm quite looking forward to the new Zelda on the Wii U.
When that comes out, that's when I'll get a Wii U.
It's already out.
Is it?
Yeah, came out last month.
All right, maybe I'll get a Wii U.
£160 for a basic or £240 for a premium.
What's that comes with the game.
Sorry?
Has premium got anything else?
It's black. It's 32 gig internal memory instead of like 4, I think, on the original. And you get a game with it.
I guess another thing, restrictions on how much hard drive space you have on a console.
32 gigabyte, I mean, come on.
I've got
shits that are bigger than 32 gigabyte. Yeah.
Each synapse of mine is bigger than 32 gigabytes. No, you can replace some of them, I think. Like the PS3, you could replace a hard drive, but no one ever did, I think. It was too much like hard work. Plus, you voided the warranty, I think.
Hard drive space isn't a premium. It's very, very cheap.
Well, yeah, even flash memory is cheap as chips now, isn't it? Yeah. Literally.
I mean, there was nothing stopping them from banging like a terabyte in there.
No, there wasn't, but yeah, it just seemed crazy.
But again, is that just so that they can then market expansions for it?
Well, it's because people, gamers, buy it, and it's the convenience, isn't it? And they just have to put up with it. Simple as that. There's not really much you can do. They produce them en masse, and you can't upgrade them. They're not expansible. Not really. I mean, they tried that a few times. Like, Nintendo brought out memory expansions and stuff for the N64, didn't they? I just saw the Commodore 64s had a.
Oh, yeah, they've been doing that for a long time. The Amiga, the Commodore 64.
Yeah, little RAM modules for the Amiga. I remember that.
They weren't really consoles, though.
No.
That Amiga 500, that's been upgraded to a 1200, I think. Or is it?
Yes, is that your original one?
Yeah. I can't really remember whether we bought it.
You had an A500, which you'd upgraded to 2 megs of RAM from. Yeah. 512 or
two
something.
2 megs. Jesus Christ. What have we become, though, honestly?
Two megs.
The fact that Windows takes 30 gig or something, you know? And Linux still doesn't take anywhere near that, does it? I've actually just got a Raspberry Pi. I bought it off a guy local, and I got a couple of memory cards with it, a box, and obviously the Raspberry Pi. A 25 quid, quite chuffed with that.
Good deal. What size memory have you got in it?
It's got a...
Mine's better.
Oh, look you all.
I've got an 8 gig and a 16 gig. I think the 16 gig's a bit dodgy, though. But I don't actually own any of those size. I've got all micro ones in my house. So. Mm. But yeah, nice little clear case. And I'm probably just going to use it for XBMC, I think, for now. But I was going to... I had a few other ideas for it. But Raspbian's installed on there as well.
Yeah, it's amazing how small it is.
Yeah, I mean, I did try and boot it up, but the TV that I've got here is 720p, so I couldn't boot it in 1080p, so it showed the Raspbian logo and then just disappeared. Yeah. So I'm going to have to plug it into a TV downstairs and reconfigure it or something.
Well, it's not as if you've got a lot of hardware to carry.
No.
Speaking of small handheld chip, like kind of computers on a chip, have you seen the Sinclair Spectrum Vega? I think it's just a Sinclair Vega. Basically, they're releasing a little handheld thing without a screen. You plug it into a TV. It's got like a D-pad on it and some buttons, but it's got 1,000
Spectrum games
built in, and it can download any of the 12,000 games.
I saw a retro on the same thing. I saw a retro console on Twitter being advertised a while back, and it was all the consoles, all with all of the slots, all in one thing, and they were actually selling it. And
yeah, I've seen that.
I was so close to getting it, but I was like, I don't trust that. I can't remember. But it was all the old consoles.
Can't be available for very long because they're going to get slapped with some copyrights.
That's exactly what I was thinking. I won't be surprised if it's not being sold already. Ooh. Sorry.
I have seen something like that. It's basically, it's just like, I think it's just like some emulators on a board with a cartridge slots.
Yeah, something like that. I didn't look into it too much. I was like, that's a pretty good idea, but yeah, I'm not sure of the legitimacy and if it would actually work properly.
It's quite a faddy thing at the moment. I think all the gift sites are still selling like the officially licensed, like a Mega Drive sort of thing, which comes with so many games.
Right.
And you can plug it into your telly and play. It's just a Mega Drive joypad with games in it. Yeah. And a HDMI cable or whatever.
They were pretty much empty anyway, old consoles. It was just the cartridge slot on a board, wasn't it? And then just plastic wrapped around it. Until you got the 360, which just I think it was just full of fans, wasn't it?
No, the original Xbox.
The original Xbox.
I meant the Xbox machine.
So. Yeah, that was... Jesus. Yeah,
that weighed more than my PC at the time.
It's one of my shelves on the wall's nearly coming off because I've got mine in it. It's ridiculous. It's hanging off the
walls.
Wall.
Coming off.
Yeah.
Building some signs.
I really do.
Storage.
I think I've only played about 2 or 3 games on that Xbox. I think I got the couple of Halos, and I didn't really... I've got thousands of games downstairs now, but I don't think I played any of them.
Burnout 3, I played loads of that. It was an excellent game. Ran it like really fast as well. Like 60 FPS on the original Xbox. It looked beautiful as well. Great game. Love that. And a really, really good feeling when you crashed, like, knocked the cars off the road. You'd, like, nudge them into oncoming traffic and they just get wiped out by a train or a bus.
Yeah, I do remember that now.
I did awesome play Destroy game. All Humans, actually. I remember playing that on the Xbox.
Yeah.
That's quite a lot of fun. It's a bit simple, you know. It's not a particularly great, well implemented game, but I quite enjoyed it. Quite interesting for me.
Yeah, I mean, I basically, it was Halo and Burnout 3 for me on the original Xbox. I mainly use for Xbox Media Center.
I can't even remember what my Xbox like control panel looks like.
I remember what the original Xbox controller looked like.
Yeah.
Oh God, yeah. I remember what it felt like. It felt like holding the Hoover Dam. Mm.
Yeah, with those pretty. Mine's see through. My pads are see through because I got an Elite Edition, and you can see the rotors moving, spinning around inside it. Mm. It's quite interesting.
But speaking about rotors, it's completely unrelated, but apparently Apple have filed a patent today for a self-writing phone.
What?
I.e., when you drop it, it'll orientate itself so it doesn't fall on the screen, apparently.
All right. Is that because their designs are shit?
That's because they've run completely out of fucking ideas, to be honest.
I've been watching some stuff recently where Gorilla Glass have been promoting, but the company that makes Gorilla Glass have been promoting themselves on YouTube using Jamie and Adam from MythBusters.
I watched that. Yeah.
Yeah. Oh God, it's what a sellout, eh? Yeah. But the point is, the screens.
But Apple don't use Gorilla Glass.
No, they don't.
They use Sapphire Glass.
Ah, right.
Which is apparently even stronger. There's a tech demo of them. And they've got one of the faces, and they're just literally bending it like that.
Right.
It doesn't break.
The point is, I guess, is that they're moving towards pretty much unbreakable screens for phones.
On the release of the iPhone 6, is that famous video where that Australian guy dropped his on the floor and cracked the screen in the first, like, 30 seconds of having it.
I haven't watched that, but I do know of it.
That was the first, as well.
One of the first people to buy one, and he dropped it while he was, like, showing it off. Like, he unboxed it and dropped it.
Oh, brilliant.
Yeah, just literally took the lid off the box, and the phone just went... He hadn't even touched it by that point.
Yeah, I bet he was not happy with that.
First in the queue. What a noob.
I also started playing some Witcher again properly a while back.
The original?
Yeah, and as I think I told you before, actually. I think I did mention it, yeah. And I killed Butterbean, by the way. He's dead easy. I tried about four or five times. Talk to you. Didn't actually take any of your advice, just kept hammering the attack key. Killed him. Easy.
I can't remember giving you any advice, to be honest.
You said you have to time it right, and I was like, no, you don't. It's completely random. There's nothing to tell you.
There's an icon that flashes above his head.
No, there isn't. There's an icon to tell you that you can attack, but it doesn't tell you that he's not going to defend. And that's what the problem was. He kept defending. Yeah, so
I was probably just attacking all out then.
No, he's just a knobhead, but he's dead now, so.
But you killed him.
Oh, I punched fuck out of him. and then I saved the game and quit again. I haven't played it since. Literally, that's all I've done in it since. But I think definitely that StarBound is my next port of call.
I might give that a squirt.
In fact, Whoop Potato Power is in-game in StarBound at the
Star
moment.
Pound.
So he's playing that game while watching us. Thanks, mate. Nice to know we're dead interesting. You're the only person watching. You could at least pay attention.
He'll be building a giant effigy to you out of limestone and tar.
A big beard effigy. A befigy.
Have any of you played Far Cry 4?
No, but it's on my list, and I'll get it when it becomes a bit cheaper, I think.
I had a conversation with Greg again, the eponymous Greg, who never appears, but we always talk about, and I think we both came to the same conclusion. It's not very good.
Yeah?
It's very much like Far Cry 3, which sounds like a good thing, because Far Cry 3 was an excellent game, but it's just the same thing over and over.
Which, you mean the same new as Far Cry 3, or all?
The same game with a new world.
Yeah.
Some slight changes to mechanics.
It did occur to me that it was quite soon after the release of 3. It's too soon after the release of 3.
It's a beautiful game, but the characters are nowhere near as good as the original. It's Far Cry 3. Vass in Far Cry 3 is one of the greatest game characters of recent memory. There's no one like that in Far Cry 3.
I'd have to agree there. He is.
He's actually based on a real person, as a real actor who did some YouTube videos, really sadistic videos of torturing people and stuff that you can watch on YouTube. There's like a viral campaign where he's showing Vast torturing these people who come up the island.
Nice.
And it basically is a real guy playing him who looks exactly like him. But yeah, Far Cry 4 just doesn't have the charm. It's just doing the same thing over and over. And but same thing as Far Cry 3, but it's just not as interesting.
I wouldn't say that Far Cry 3 had much charm. I mean, I didn't particularly connect with the protagonist. I didn't particularly connect with the story missions.
No.
I enjoyed the exploration.
Yeah, I did as well.
That
and
was about
the problem is that the world, as beautiful as it is in Far Cry 4, isn't as interesting as a desert island in Far Cry 3.
Yeah.
Because it's just mountains.
Well, I might wait a little bit then. Even longer, in fact, and I'll just get it when it's in a sale.
It's also really buggy, just like Far Cry 3 was, in that I had to play through the intro 5 times because it wasn't saving my checkpoints, and I had to go into a config file to turn off mouse acceleration because doing it from the menus didn't work.
Oh, get fucked, Ubisoft. Get fucked. It's just such a newbie mistake. Swear to God, there's no need to release a PC game with the amount of resources they have that's got little things like that missing from it. You're appealing to PC gamers, for God's sake. They want more control. Oh.
Clearly, PC gamers these days aren't as discerning about the mouse input, but I cannot play a game with mouse acceleration.
I can't do it. I turn it off all the time as well.
I want to know that when I move my mouse a certain distance that I'm going to turn a certain distance.
Yeah. Regardless of speed, you should be able to turn slowly and reach the same point as quickly. Maybe it's something to do with when we started playing games, because when we started playing FPSs on the PC, mouse acceleration wasn't available.
No, it wasn't. I mean, it didn't come until Windows XP. So no games had it before then. And when XP came out and we all suddenly realised that it was being forced in the game, we made a big fuss about it.
Mm.
And now it's accepted. Now, I don't understand why you would ever put mouse acceleration into a game with mouse control. There is no good reason for that I can see.
It's the amount of space that you've got available to you and how fast you move your mouse, isn't it? So the less space you need. You can still get used to it and play just as well as someone without mouse acceleration.
I think acceleration works on a thumbstick.
Because
you've got a very finite amount of space you can move in. Whereas with a mouse, you know, if you haven't got enough room, just move your hand to a different place where there is more room.
Yeah.
And
I never run out of mouse mat. And I just have a normal size mouse mat.
But then again, we've learned how to use it. That's why it's part of a wireless mouse. We've learned where the stops are and how to deal with those stops when we're playing games as well, with the mouse.
It's interesting when you watch someone play with a mouse and they're kind of lifting the mouse up just instinctually now, lifting it up to reposition it at the center, so automatically centering the mouse.
I have no problem with that personally. I think that's how it should be. I don't like mouse acceleration because if I accidentally move my mouse a bit too far, I like to know that when I move it 3 inches to the left, it's going to reach the end of my screen, you know? I don't want it to, you know, sometimes be at the other end of my other monitor over there, or sometimes be, depending on how quickly I do it. I don't like that.
Well, the thing is, with mouse acceleration, it kind of goes against muscle memory.
Mm.
Because if you know that you can move your wrist, you know, so far over to get the edge of the screen, but if you do it in a panic and it goes twice that distance,
it's temporal, isn't it?
Yeah,
you've got to learn the timing as well as the amount. So you've got double the kind of the things to worry about.
Mm.
And you shouldn't have to worry about it. No, stop doing it, developers.
Because these things are already analog.
Mm.
It's not digital. It's not like
we have as much acceleration as we need within our own limbs.
If I want to turn faster, I shall move my wrist faster.
Yeah, or put the sensitivity up if I want it to be.
It's just another repercussion of the age of convenience, guys. I'm telling you. I'm going to keep saying this until everyone is aware of it.
It's an awful feature and it should be banned. There should be legislation worldwide. The Geneva Convention shit.
I'd go with that. I'd go with that.
Down with boob tubes.
Yeah. We should form a party. We should form a party and maybe Maybe we should oust everybody who does use a mouse acceleration and burn them, put them could in concentration camps.
Could I also suggest then, as another punishable offence, that anyone who's using WASD and has not switched to ESDF should be punched in the face until dead?
Why?
Because you're giving yourself an extra set of keys. WASD means there's certain keys you can't use.
Such as?
Caps lock.
That's a key you can't use.
Right, okay.
You can so use
why
it,
can't I use it?
You can use it as a toggle button.
Yeah, but if you go to ASDF, then you've got A in the same place, which is a proper key, and you've got extra keys that are in reach of your pinky. There's no reason to use WASD.
Yes, there is, because this is the pinky that presses the other keys, right? It's not as sensitive, and it can't reach as many places, so having the bigger buttons, Control, Shift, Caps Lock, Tab, are easier to press.
You're
a lefty,
wrong.
Lou. You are not qualified to make this to have this conversation with me.
That was a good response, actually. I'm behind Steve on that one. Shut up, Lou.
Oh, fuck you. I'll make my own party.
You don't know out.
What about the guys in the chat? Do they like mouse acceleration?
Let's wait for them. Is it important in Minesweeper? No. In fact, yes, because I turn it off in Windows as well, because I hate it. It's like that snap to OK buttons and stuff like that you can turn on.
Whoop Potato Power was saying the shift and control keys are better with WASD for pressing. And they are, I agree. Plus, if you're playing there with ESDF, the position that the crawl would be is the Windows button, and that's the last thing you want to press when you're playing a game.
I was holding that up the entire time you were staring down then, expecting you to look up and go...
I did look up, but I just didn't know what you were doing because you were sideways.
Because you were doing that for too long.
If you're talking about limitations on keys as well, you use the arrow keys. There's nothing else around them apart from the arrow keys.
Whereas you could use IJKL.
I know that. Yeah? I know that. I know that.
Why don't you use 4, 5, 6 and 8?
4, 5, 6 and 8?
Or 4, 5,
6 keys around them.
Because I press back.
No.
That's why. I don't play like that and use the my middle finger to go forwards and backwards. I actually have a single finger for each control. So I play like that.
Yeah, so how is that any different from using the arrow keys? Because they're still in the same position relatively.
Yeah, but you're saying if I use 4, 5, 6 and 8.
Well, use 1, 2, 3 and 5.
If I wasn't forced out of using my mouse to strafe, then I'd still be doing it. And it's still the better than all of your control techniques, so shove off.
The only thing that works, Steve, is if I did 1, 5, 3 and 0.
Yeah.
But then I'd have less keys at my disposal there.
You'd have less keys?
No, you wouldn't.
Yeah, I would, because with the cursor island, I've got keys on the left. Whereas the only key I've got on the left from there is the right cursor key.
Okay, yeah. Well, why don't you use semicolon?
Why don't you just stop playing games entirely, Lou?
And set yourself on fire.
Set yourself on fire and jump off a bridge onto a load of flaming donkeys.
No.
Did I go too far then?
Anyway, yeah, we all have our own control systems. I can still beat you at Quake.
You whooped me at Quake. I was actually just watching the videos again because I happened to find them in from the LAN. I'm horrific. I am so embarrassed by that.
You never played me, though.
Yes, I did. I beat you.
What, the LAN?
No, not the LAN, but I beat you at Quake before.
Oh, like 15 years ago, Lou.
Have you been practicing since then, have you?
Every day.
Oh.
7 hours.
I can't believe I couldn't bunny hop, though. I felt so disabled when I played that.
Well, you were using a different control scheme.
I couldn't either way, because when I changed back to my normal control scheme, my old control scheme rather, I just kept firing at the floor and jumping when I should have been strafing.
I've tried to switch to playing right-handed, and I've had the same thing as you. You get into that situation where you can't do either right, so you have to go back, because at least you can still do it with that way.
I'm going to have a play and see if I can bunny hop, but it's Quake 2, it's obsolete. Shouldn't matter anymore, but it does. It really matters to me. I love it though when you and I have a really close Quake match. I really enjoy it. I get exhilarated from it, and that's what I was looking for the LAN party. Instead, I was just sat there going, I'm not even angry because I just can't believe how terrible I'm playing.
Not even angry, I'm just disappointed.
Yeah, I'm not even angry, I just hate myself.
Not angry, I'm just slightly aroused.
That as well. Oh, that's another thing that I play Lou for. Arousal.
Alright, okay. I'm happy to contribute.
I haven't played too many other games. One game I am going to be playing soon, which has been in every single Humble Bundle and Steam sale ever, like since I started looking at games again recently, is that State of Decay, if you've heard of it.
I've heard of it. I
keep seeing it pop up, but I've never really looked that much into it, so I've just assumed it was crap.
Well, I got it in a bundle at some point, and I actually saw a review for it recently. And they said, it's actually surprisingly good. Grab it.
What type of game is it?
It's a zombie survival single player thing. But
yeah, that's probably why I ignored it.
Yeah, but that's, I mean, I again look for zombie games so I can spend some time playing games with my wife. So I'm quite looking forward to having a go with that.
Very positive reviews.
What Potato Powers just said, when Spikeh becomes an old person, he will sit in his chair saying to himself, I can't believe I could not bunny jump. You're right there, mate. You're totally right.
Bunny jump? What the hell's bunny jumping?
Come on, he's not English. Give the guy a break. He blatantly doesn't know how to form a sentence.
Well, I didn't know he wasn't English. Where is he from?
I don't know. He won't tell me anything about himself.
Where are you from
with Potato Powers?
I have a feeling that he's not actually a real person, or he may be somebody that is...
You could do the Turing test on him.
Yeah. I don't think it'd work, though, because his English is so bad. I bet he's English, you know, as well. I'm sorry if you are, mate.
I don't think he is.
I don't think he is, but...
Red Faction Collection's got 85% off. That's still not appealing.
No, it doesn't. I did like the original Red Faction, because it was an interesting mechanic, Destructible Worth. I just read Earth as I was reading that.
What's the Game of Thrones game like?
That's one of the guys who did The Walking Dead.
Yeah, the same ones who'd done the Tales from Borderlands.
Yeah, that's it. Yeah. And it's a proper licensed game. It's got real characters. I don't know if it's got the voices. It's got Peter Dinklage in it, but I don't know if it's actually Peter Dinklage.
Weren't Telltale an indie studio that have now become quite popular for the Walking Dead game? Oh, there's ones before that.
I don't know if they're indie.
They did Back to the Future before that. Is it there's and two, I think.
There's also an indie game that I've just kind of shot up in my face when I booted Steam called I Am Bread.
That's going around Twitter at the moment, and it was on the Steam sale. And it sounds, you're just bread, that's what you are.
Yeah, it's like you're a slice of bread and you just kind of flop about the place and...
Like some kind of weird Katamari Damacy thing. You're going to roll over things and pick up things to make a sandwich.
He's in the bathroom at the minute, and obviously the bread doesn't want to fall in the bath because it'll dissolve.
Someone posted a Twitter status, and it could have been automatic from the actual game itself, I'm not sure, but it was saying, I was bread, you can be bread, and then a link. That's it. So I think it's just is that art?
Oh! If when you start the game, you launch bread.exe, that will be the best thing ever.
For you?
Of
course it'll be bread.exe.
Sorry, I just had a call there.
I don't know.
I think I might give that one a miss.
What's that, Game of Thrones?
No, the bread. Iron Bread. It looks very gimmicky. It's one of these ones, you know, like Octodad and Simulator Surgeon, where it's like a really obscure control mechanism and you're just like really awkwardly moving about the place.
It's the Quop style game, isn't it?
Yeah.
So much laughter when I play those games, though. Quop, I laughed out my face off. And
yeah, I must admit, I laughed my head off when I played Quop.
Surgeon Simulator is still in my favourites on in Steam. I keep meaning to play it and actually try and complete it. But...
Do you know what I was toying with downloading the other day? Goat Simulator.
Yeah,
just see what it's like.
I
kind of feel like I'm too experienced at the internet to be a fan of
duped.
Stuff like that. Like
duped by that, you mean?
Yeah, but
apparently they just released like a multiplayer patch for it.
No, it's not multiplayer. It's an MMO simulator, but it's single player.
Right.
So it's got like fetch quests and experience and stuff like that, but it's all just taking the piss out of World of Warcraft, basically. But it's not multiplayer at all. It simulates multiplayer.
I've got better things to do with my time, you know, like play real serious games. And the thing is, he released that as a joke. It went absolutely mental and crazy, and he's done really well off it, and God bless him, you know.
Who's that?
It was just Gary's mod, wasn't it?
Armin Brav.
Tweaked a little bit.
Oh, no, what game are you talking about? Goat Simulator.
Goat Simulator.
Yeah. Yeah, they posted something on the internet saying, like, something like, wouldn't a Goat Simulator be awesome or something? And everyone said, yes, it would be. Please
wasn't
make it.
Was it done for April Fools or something?
It was something like that, yeah. But it just basically, everyone said to them, we want you to make this game. So they just knocked it up in Unity. I think it was Unity. It was Unity or UDK.
I think it was UDK. I think it was UDK.
Yeah, I think you're right, actually.
But I remember, again, I remember them releasing it on last year on April... Well, yeah, no, this year. This year on April Fool's Day. And everyone was like, what? Really?
Well, yeah. Everyone was like, I have seen the reviews for it. Like, everyone's in on the joke.
Yeah. Because like, it's cool to be in on the joke, but I haven't got the time for that.
That's,
you know,
kind of why I've avoided it, because it's like, I don't want to be in on jokes like that. I don't want to be Mr. Internet with my YOLO t-shirt.
Yeah.
You know what
I
mean?
Don't get me started on that. That isn't what this show's about. My misanthropic rants about humanity in general. Although I could. Anything else anyone's been playing or anyone's expecting to play soon?
Oh, I did boot up Steam, so I can look in my library. I've just been looking at the store.
I haven't actually done too much recently, I'll be honest.
Did anyone buy anything in the sale?
No.
Yeah, I bought Fortress Craft. I've got one game that I'm actually really quite looking forward to playing. The Banner Saga. And I got something else.
Have you guys seen Evolve? Been keeping up to date on that?
That's yes.
The 4v1 game.
Oh, yes. I haven't kept up to date with it, but I've read about it.
I watched some gameplay of that, and it looked really cool, actually. It looked like a proper old-school Twitch game, but with really nice modern graphics, and the twist in that the monster, it's like 4v1. I think that's quite a cool idea.
I've heard of that, Evolve. Is that on the PS4?
I don't know. I saw it on some console. I think it was Xbox One.
I think I might have read about it in... Isn't it done by the same people that did a similar game to that? Brain. Stop it. Don't matter.
Turtle Rock did it. But yeah, basically, you pick your class. I think you pick your class or something like that. And you go up against a monster, and that monster's got 3 levels, I think. And the longer the game lasts, the higher, the more like levels up the monster gets, something like that. Right. And you get like a class which has got a dog or something, and it can sniff the monster out, and another class which can make, like, seal off an area so that the monster can't escape from you. And then you have a fight in like a sort of an arena that's made out of a giant bubble. All kinds of stuff like that. There's some really interesting ideas in it. I think it just looks fun though, because I've always, since I played Left 4 Dead, I've loved the idea of being the monster. There's something really cool about being the enemies.
Well, Alien vs. Predator did that though, didn't it?
It did, yeah.
Especially kind the multiplayer for the original AVP game. I actually really enjoyed that. As much as it was difficult and it's a bit shit by today's standards, I really liked playing multiplayer on that. It was well fun. I remember playing at a LAN party with you guys, actually.
Yeah, I remember that as well. AVP Gold.
Yeah, well, it's gold now.
When I bought SimCity, Origin gave me a free game. And it was the worst game I have ever played. I'm not saying this lightly either. It was made, well, I don't know when it was. It just, every aspect of it is horrible. The sound, the graphics, the controls. It's called Crusader, No Remorse.
I've heard of that.
Yeah, it's terrible.
I've heard of that, and it's Isomeric, isn't it? It looks like a game that I would really enjoy.
No, it's...
This is going to be a Lone Soldier moment. I'm looking at screenshots and thinking that game looks absolutely mint.
Really?
Yeah. But I
what screenshots are you looking at?
I'm looking at Crusader No Remorse screenshots. I love isometric games. I love isometric games, especially old pixel art games.
Do you want a truly terrible game that was bought for me by my mother? It's actually published by Ubisoft. Jesus. Truly, truly terrible game.
Go on.
Bard's Tale.
Now, I've heard that's good as well. I've actually, I think I got that for iOS.
Look at the strap line.
A quest for coin and cleavage.
Yeah, but it's based on the original, which was also like that. The original kind of took some leaves from Monkey Island's book. It tried to be kind of a comedy RPG.
Yeah. Well, a tagline for Crusader No Remorse is, if you don't have a bad attitude, you don't have a chance.
You will have to play in this game.
Yeah, you'll have a fucking very bad attitude. Louio, if I could give it to you, somehow I am quite prepared to do that. I hate this game.
I don't want it, but it just... It's the game where the screenshots alone would sway me to buy it. It's the same reason that I bought an isometric game on my Xbox. Not my Xbox. My PlayStation. I can't remember the name of it, but it was shite. But I bought it just because it looked like a cool isometric game.
Shite metric.
That's very Irish, isn't it?
I shit metric.
I shit imperial.
Yeah. Divided by 2.5, 2.436, or whatever it is.
I only shit in grams.
You shit imperial. No, metric.
Shit imperial. That's like really bad stuff.
Fucking always get it wrong. I'm in the process of writing a BMI calculator for something at work, and it's just converting from metric to imperial and explaining.
It doesn't work.
Just no, it doesn't. It don't ask me. I'm not the one who suggested using a BMI calculator to approve insurance underwriting procedures, but that's what they do, unfortunately. So if your BMI is out, which I am massively obese, according to I mean, I am a mountain. Yeah, I am a mountain according to my BMI. I'm like clinically, like dangerously obese, and I'm overweight, yes, but not that far. Not that.
No, you're really tall. You're 6'2", aren't you, or something?
6'3", yeah.
Six, yeah.
And then I'm about that in height as well. Yeah. But yeah, I was writing it and having to explain to users who don't really do maths and don't really get the conversions how there's always going to be a remainder when you convert from feet and inches to centimeters. There's always going to be a remainder that gets lost somewhere. That's trying to explain that is difficult.
Are you talking about precision, like when you convert and decimal places?
Essentially, they wanted a calculator that converts from metric to imperial, and then if you go to the imperial box and type in the imperial, it'll convert it back to metric. And I've got it so it doesn't lose precision now, but it took me a while to get it right, and they had to accept that the metric is always going to have loads of decimal places on it. You know, so
you have to just get it round up.
No, because if you round it up, then when you convert back to metric or back to imperial, it just breaks.
To round up on screen.
Yeah, I was going to say, just for the view.
That's the way that Excel works.
I did think about that, but I didn't tell them that I could do it that, I'll be honest. I thought, you know what? Till there.
Screw you guys.
Yeah.
Right.
I was thinking I might start playing Daikatana. For some reason, that's in my library.
I haven't played that. It's apparently terrible, isn't it?
It's Quake 2 engine, isn't it?
I think I must have got it in a Humble Bundle because I have not bought this.
It was available in a Humble Bundle a while back. I didn't get that bundle because I was like, almost want to play Daikatana, but I know that it's terrible, so...
John Romero wants to make you his bitch!
Is there some sort of free play thing going on this weekend? Because for some reason I've got all the Hitman games as well.
I don't know. It's a fiver, by the way, Daikatana.
Did any of you ever play Max Payne 3?
I haven't played any of the Max Payne games.
I played 1 and 2, but not 3.
Max Payne 3 was very good. A significant step in story and in the game engine itself.
Again, I know it got good reviews and I do intend to play it, but I also intend to play all 5 million of the other games that I've got.
If you do get the chance to play Max Payne 3, I'd thoroughly recommend it.
Third person put me off again. The same reason I haven't played the Hitman games, despite the fact that the most recent one's supposed to be quite good. One of the recent ones is meant to be really good.
I've got Absolution Sniper Challenge. I got them in some Humble Bundle. I think Absolution's the latest, isn't it?
I think it might be, yeah. One of them got really good reviews.
Absolution, Silent Assassin, and Codename 47 in my library for some reason.
Right.
I played the first one, I think. I played the first one on PC well after it came out on PlayStation, and quite enjoyed it, but I found it extremely difficult, Hitman. Really, really difficult, to the point where I wasn't really enjoying it that much. But my fault again that I actually played it on hard setting. So
I think it's Absolution that basically lets you kill people in whatever way you want. Like, it doesn't prescribe a method for each assassination. You basically just give an environment full of dangerous things for them to die on.
Well, it, I think they did that in most of the Hitman games, though, didn't they?
But I don't know, I haven't played any of them.
Oh, yeah, no, all of them had multiple ways you could... Well, as far as
I remember killing someone with a plastic bag.
Yeah,
the
I remember...
Piano Wire was the famous one, isn't it?
There was one I remember where you walked... It was in a theme park or something, and you walked... you could either strangle this guy with a garrote, or you could put poison pills in his cup, or you could just shoot him in the head. But it all left different evidence, and you got a different kind of completion score for it.
I know.
But I do, again, that's one I've bought that I bought purposefully to play Absolution, and I haven't yet got round to it. God damn it, the amount of games.
I'm trying to think what else I've played or I'm looking forward to playing.
Well, the only game that I'm looking forward to, the only two games that I'm looking forward to playing is one I've got for Christmas, which I've already mentioned, The Last of Us, and Phantom Pain, when that comes out. They're the only two games that I'm even slightly excited about.
Yeah, like I said, I'm looking forward to Moon Man. I'm looking forward to playing Elite, which I bought. I'm just waiting for it to be released. So I think it's sometime this month. I'll need to grab myself a joystick and all the rest of it. Next year, I don't know. I mean, I'm interested in that No Man's Sky, but I probably won't be able to play it because it's going to be a console-only game.
Mm.
And I'm kind of sceptical that they'll actually manage to get much into it.
I'm not sure I want to buy it straight off. I'm never pre-ordering a game ever again, by the way. I've told you this before. But even when the games do come out, I'm giving them a bit of room, you know, before I actually buy them now.
Do you know the taste in my mouth that is left from No Man's Sky? It's the same as Spore, and they had a lot of hype about, you know, you can do anything with this game, and actually you can't really. And I know you two both played Spore recently.
I got it
not recently. Chris has just jizzed a bit.
No, I've jizzed a bit because that's another game I've been playing. I got it on the Steam sale because I bought it. I had it ages ago. I think I had a cracked copy, and it was I found it quite fun, and I played it again recently. But unfortunately, I got all the way to the tribal stage. Just before I clicked the tribal stage button, a big monster came over and killed me. Huge monster thing that I couldn't have any chance of killing. And then the game crashed. So I had to go back to the beginning of the land stage as soon as you get on land. So I was like, oh, I can't be arsed right now. But I'll do it again.
So I actually quite fancy playing again. That's Black and White.
I thought you were going to say that.
I have played that quite a few times, but I've never got past like the second or third world. Because I just got a bit bored of it after that.
Was there a sequel?
It was Black and White 2 that I'm thinking about specifically. We're at a LAN party, and it came out relatively recently. And I'd done the whole... I had a pet, and I'd built him up, and I'd taught him things. And one of our, well, I suppose you could say friends at the time, he'd basically got a trainer and just made his monster as big as possible, give him all the magic, and then just basically sent him out on a rampage. And he was convinced that he was going to kill me, so we had a pitch battle between our monsters, and my monster just slapped him all over the place, despite being like a quarter of the size. He just like, it was just more intelligent because I'd taught him stuff, so he knew straight away that if he came over to keep him at distance and just keep casting ranged spells on him. He just set him on fire.
I don't think I played 2, you know, Black and White 2.
It was good. It brought in like the multiplayer aspect of it.
Yeah, I don't think I have.
Is it Lionhead Studios?
Yes, it was.
Same people made Fable and that, wasn't it?
Have either of you seen From Dust?
From Yes.
It's a God style game, like what you've just been talking about, by Eric Chahi.
I heard it didn't get too good reviews though.
I'm just looking on there. It came out when it was... I Ubisoft. Played demo and it was published by Ubisoft, but it's basically all Eric Chahi. I hope I'm pronouncing that right. I don't know how you pronounce it properly. It got favourable reviews, and I enjoyed the demo.
It looked alright, but I'm sure I read a few reviews, or I read something that it wasn't very good.
Did you not play the full game then, Liv?
I didn't know I was playing the demo. I actually forgot about it, to be honest.
It does look quite black and whitey.
It is very similar, but the whole thing is you control the landscape and the seas and stuff. And it's quite clever physics in it.
I did play Reyes recently, which is a 2D kind of god game, and you've got this.
Oh yes, is that the isometric one? And
it's not isometric. It's just 2D.
Reyes,
R-E-U-S, and it's just basically a big planet, and you have different giants and monsters that you send around the planet to form different parts of the world. Then it becomes like a resource management game once you've formed all the world, and you can prevent natural disasters and things like that. But I just got into it a little bit, and I was like, I can't be arsed. It's the same as Banished. I played that a little bit, really in depth, really detailed, really interesting, but too complicated for me, you know. For
the thing with Banished is that there was no end game in view.
What, in Banished?
Yeah, you couldn't complete the game. You just keep expanding and expanding and expanding, and kind of once you'd got a few seasons under your belt, started balancing your resources. You're like, well, there's not really a do now.
Doesn't seem to be much game in that game. I got it. I followed the development of that game for a long time, and it was really interesting to watch how he made the game. But the game itself wasn't as interesting as the development process.
Yeah,
it's just like there was nothing to do in the game. It's kind of the curse of. We can do all these things with the game, but can we make it a game?
Yeah.
And usually the answer's no. You can put all the mechanics you like and all the clever things and pathfinding and procedural farming and all the rest of it, but is that fun? Not really.
That's one of the things that I'm kind of facing a challenge of my game at the moment is how can I make it into a game? How can I give it a, you know, without adding too much production value and it becoming a AAA game, which if I had that budget, yes, I could make it a game, but because I don't know where, you know, how to make it more fun than it is. I'm hoping it will be. I'm hoping it'll appeal to some people at least anyway. But you always face that, I think, as a developer. Anyway, I think we should close the show up because we're lagging a bit. And I said this was a bit of a ad hoc impromptu kind of just gab about games. Unless there's anything you guys have anything to say about, we'll...
I can't think of anything. I think I've covered everything I've played and would like to play.
Yeah, I'll probably remember loads of stuff the second that I click close. But hey, who cares? Yeah. I think I'm going to probably not do any game dev tonight, actually. But I might potentially play a bit of StarBound, see if I can get into that, possibly. Not sure. But anyway, so thanks for watching, everybody. Thanks for everyone in the chat. And we shall see you next week. Next week, hopefully, Sam will be back and we'll be talking about death in games, specifically.
Yeah.
And how we deal with it and the different types of deaths and Snake. Yeah, I don't know why I did that. That was totally the wrong voice.
I don't know where that was like Snake saying to himself.
It wasn't.
He's about to slash his wrist, Snake.
I've got the impression in my head that Snake is a lot gruffer than he actually is. But when I hear Snake doing, you know, David Hayter doing Snake's
sounds
voice,
like Pee Wee Herman.
Yeah, he's quite a lot less gruff than I remember.
Next week's topic, Whoop Potato Power, is going to be death
and Minesweeper.
Yes.
I just died in Minesweeper, so I'm gonna talk about that in depth.
It's I think it's quite interesting to talk about how we perceive it, basically. But again, we shall cover that next week, and hopefully we'll have a little bit more intelligent discussion because the intelligent one is back.
Yeah, just to reiterate, the topic will be death.
Yes. As in the opposite of life.
Yes, death in games specifically. Yeah. We're not just going to talk about.
No, it's
going to
be like
dying.
2 hours of snuff movies. Well, we could do that as a special.
We could do that as the extras afterwards. We could do an encore after we've drawn the credits at the end. Anyway, thank you, everybody. We'll see you next week.
See you later.
Bye.